Good morning, everybody. My name is Ana Maria Lopez, and I belong to CIRCE, the Research Center for Energy Resources and Consumption. More specifically, I work in the Eco-Efficiency and Environmental Analysis Group in the Energy Efficiency Area of CIRCE. Among other topics, we are involved in different issues, research projects, and teaching courses about energy, energy efficiency, environmental impacts, and pollutant emissions. In this time, as part of the courses dedicated to policies in the electricity and heat supply sector, I'm going to teach a class focused on emission standards for electricity and heat supply sector. Taking into account the main objective of this course, this lesson try to cover the main aspect related to the emission standards in the electricity and heat sector. Firstly, an introduction to the energy sector and emissions associated is going to be carried out to show what the current scenario to be committed is. After that, a brief description of the standards and other policies will be performed to finally focus on the environmental policies and more specifically in the definition of the ambient and emission standards. Another important point is to describe, at least as a general point, how a standard can be set and implemented. Finally, the lesson will be focused on the European case, where main standards will be described and also some ideas about the future trends will be commented. To start with the emission standard lesson, it is necessary to approach the emission concept. Emissions are defined as any kind of substance, gas, liquid, or solid released into the air from natural or human sources. However, although not all emissions become air pollutants, most of them can be that, causing significant health and environmental problems. One of these is the carbon dioxide or CO2. The 90% of the total CO2 emissions come from fossil fuel combustion. Therefore, they are affected by the following three main factors: energy demand or the level of energy intensive activity, in particular related to power generation, basic material industry, or road transport. Also, is affected by the changes in the energy efficiency, and finally, by the shift in fuel mix, such as from carbon intensive coal to low carbon gas, or from fossil fuels to nuclear or renewable energies. In case of Europe, the primary energy production evolutions since 1990 to 2012, considering different sources, is represented in the first figure. The data show that fossil fuel consumption changed the behavior. Although most of them were increasing the consumption up to 2000, after that they had a gradual descent. However, the renewable energy production, which suffers an abrupt increment since 2002, can be seen in the figure. On the other hand, the final energy consumption by fuel in absolute values shows the high relevance that the petroleum product and gas have nowadays, especially in case of the total petroleum products. Also, it is important to remark the relevance of the electricity energy consumption, which is quite similar to the gas consumption as can be seen in the figure. However, if we analyze the total primary energy supply in the world, The tendencies observed are quite different from those shown in the Europe previously. In this case, fossil fuel consumption was increasing along the time, being the renewable energy less relevant. Additionally, the historical trends in global energy mix between 1970 and the early 2000s shows a steady increase in the share of natural gas consumption in the total primary energy mix. The stagnation of the natural gas share since 2002 has not been due to an absolute decrease in gas consumption, but trend breaks in the relative growth rate of natural gas and oil sales were due to the much higher growth rate of coal consumption since 2002. This strong increase in the coal consumption was mainly caused by the fast developing economy of China. Changing the approach, in this figure, we can see the final energy consumption in the European Union, but in this case, represented by sectors. The data demonstrate that there are three main sectors which account the highest energy consumption values, mainly in heat or electricity, of course. They are the industry, the road transport, and the residential sector, with similar quotes in 2012 as can be seen in the figure. On the other hand, services or other transport show quite low consumption in comparison with the other three main sectors before saying. Focusing on the CO2 emissions from fossil fuel combustion by sectors, but considering the entire world, we can see in this table that power generation, industry, and road transport are the main pollutant sources in terms of CO2. Additionally, analyzing the fuel typology, the coal combustion globally is responsible for the 43% of total CO2 emission from fossil fuel combustion, with 28% emitted from coal-fired power plants. Industry, in particular, iron and steel manufacturing, is the second largest sources, as can be seen. In case of coal, its use can be considered country-specific. In this sense, it is possible to find that the share of coal in the energy mix of the top 25 countries varies, for example, from 33% in case of United States to 43% in India, 47% in China, and even 49% in case of Poland. As was mentioned at the beginning of the lesson, fossil fuel combustion accounts for about 90% of the total global CO2 emissions, excluding those from forest fires and the use of wood fuel. However, the trends in fossil fuel combustion and fossil mix are linked to the global economy. In 2012, data showed that the global economy continued to grow around 3% in most countries. This fact made that global energy consumption show an actual growth of 1.5%. This situation represents half the average growth over the last decade. On the other hand, there are different tendencies in the CO2 emission depending on the country. The trends in the countries membered in the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, also called OECD countries, and the non-OECD countries are diverging, with a 1.4% decline. In the first one, OECD countries versus a close to 3% increase in non-OECD countries. Come back to the previous figure about the total primary energy supply by type. It's possible to deduce the worldwide trends in fossil fuel combustion. Global fossil oil consumption increased in 2012 because the China oil consumption increased by around 5% and accounted for more than half of the increases in oil trade in 2012, with oil import increasing by approximately 7%. Additionally, natural gas consumption increased also globally in this year. Among countries with more than 2% share in the world's natural gas consumption, the largest increase took place in Arabia Saudi, around 11%, Japan and China, more or less with 10%, Mexico, close to 9%, and the United States with approximately 4%. However, in contrast to these tendencies, after the largest decline on records in 2011 due to the world weather, a weak economy, high gas prices, and increasing renewable electricity production, consumption in the European Union continued to decrease in 2012, mainly caused by declines in the United Kingdom and Italy. In case of coal consumption, which accounts for almost one-third of global energy consumption, increased globally in 2012, being China again with a share of 50% more or less in global coal consumption, one of the most relevant countries. Anyway, after a large increase in coal consumption in 2010 and 2011, China increased less in 2012. Other relevant country in coal consumption is India. However, consumption in OECD countries decreases, especially in the United States, and smaller declines in Australia and in Canada. In contrast, increases are observed in the European Union, around 3%, caused by Spain, the United Kingdom, France, and Germany, especially. Finally, trends in renewable energy sources show an increment in the energy supply, avoiding some traditional fuels. Actually, half of the electricity generating capacity expected globally in 2020 consisted of renewable energy. Before we can really move forward and explore emission standards in depth, we need to take a look at the types of policy that can be employed to achieve environmental and energy goals. As you read through this part of the lesson, be thinking about how different policy instruments are either more or less appropriate for different environmental-related issues. First, it is important to clarify two different concepts: what is legislation and what is a regulation. The first one, legislation, is defined as a law that has been enacted by some type of governing body, for example, Congress, the president, or some other governing body. However, implement a legislation is hard and long, and before it was passed into law, it was likely referred to as a bill. One example of legislation could be the clean air policy in the European Union. On the other hand, Regulation refers to the way that a legislation is actually enacted on the ground. This can take on many forms, as you will see after that. Regulation are the details of the implementation for achieving the desired effects of the legislation. An example of regulation could be a directive of the European Parliament on ambient air quality and cleaner air for Europe enter. In this sense, there are many types of regulation to enact an environmental legislation. The first one could be taxes. Taxes are the regulation which involves levying a change on a unit of goods or services. For example, a taxation for the purpose of limiting carbon emissions. By taxing the carbon content of the fossil fuels, we try to make alternative energy resources, for example, wind, solar, biomass, most cost competitive. In addition to believing the playing field for these newer technologies, taxing carbon also raises revenue, which can then be funneled back into programs to reduce the emissions further. Another type is the subsidies and grants. Subsidies, incentives, and grants are those regulations that address environmental issues by offering incentives and grants rather than explicitly requiring action of any kind. This could include direct payments for a specific type of project or research, grant money to support research in part or in a whole, tax credit for a specific type of purchases or activities, or a price support or subsidy for a specified activity. Although it is more difficult to predict an achieved level of success because the participation is voluntary, this voluntary nature makes it a popular intermediate step between no regulation at all and some sort of mandatory compliance mandate like a tax or a standard. The next one type of regulation included here is the guidelines. Guidelines like incentives and grants represent a voluntary opportunity to encourage citizens, business, or communities to adopt certain practices. Guidelines aim to facilitate the adoption of specified practices. However, no one is required to follow them. Guidelines tend to be a smaller scale policy instrument. Another one is the market mechanism. Sometimes policies lay the framework for the establishment of a market-based system to achieve policy goals. One of the most notable forms of this is a system of tradable permits, also known as a cap and trade or trade system. Cap and trade gained mass notoriety in the recent years as a potential legislative option for handling carbon emissions in the United States and Europe. In case of the European Union, a trading scheme for carbon emission was adopted under the Kyoto Protocol. And finally, standards are established to achieve a certain amount of environmental benefit. To do that, standards mandate that a particular activity be done, like in case of the renewable electricity standards in the United States, say that 20% of a state's electricity should be generated from renewable sources by a given year. Another type of standards related to the energy policy will be the adoption of best available control technologies. This is commonly applied to new stationary sources of emissions and can include anything from emission control devices to emission limits or techniques. Considering this variety of regulation, it is important to understand how policy instruments work for different types of environmental challenges. That means, will tax credit incentivize enough behavioral changes to make a dent in the residential greenhouse gas emission? Will a carbon tax unduly harm the poorest families in the country? Will increased funding for carbon capture and sequestration be the answer to continuing to use the abundant resources of coal without increasing greenhouse gas emissions? Therefore, understanding how works the different policy options will give you the skills you need to make grounded decisions about effective and practical policy programs. In these lessons, of course, we are going to focus on environmental policies and specifically considering the standards as regulation. The environmental policy towards emission controls is not an easy aspect. Actually, in many cases, it has led to overlapping policies that combine more than one instrument, typically ambient standard with emission standards on common pollutants. Therefore, it is important to clarify firstly what is the meaning of this concept, and particularly which are the main differences. So, what is an ambient standard? This concept refers to the requirements that specify the maximum amount of pollutant a building, work area, or a site may be allowed to have in its surroundings. On the other hand, we have also to analyze the emission standard definition. An emission standard is the maximum amount of a specific pollutant allowed to be discharged into the atmosphere from a single fixed or mobile sources. In other words, emission standards are legal requirements governing air pollutant release into the atmosphere. Emission standards set quantitative limits on the permissible amount of specific air pollutants that may be released from specific sources over specific timeframes. They are generally designed to achieve air quality standards and to protect human health. This regulatory value is a quantitative limit on the emission or discharges of a potential toxic substance from a source and not a concentration in the surroundings, as it was the ambient standard. The simplest form for regulatory purpose is an uniform emission standard where the same limit is placed on all emissions of a particular contaminant. So, after defining what is an emission standard, the next question are related to set the standards. First one. Should be who? In case of emission standard, the responsible authority is in charge of setting the standards. To do that, the standard can be set considering different aspects. For example, sometimes setting emission standard is based on data concerning the emissions performance and cost of available technologies. However, other times, as the setting air quality standards for common air pollutants is based on protection of public health and welfare. Focusing on setting emission standard based on technology performance, some aspects can be described. First, performance standards, not technology requirement. This means it sets emission performance level rather than mandating use of a particular technology. Second, state limits based on technology performance and cost. In this case, states require available controls for existing stationary sources, for example, factories, to help meet and maintain air quality standards. Finally, promoting technology improvement and standards based on the best performance that consider to set standards that require at least the level of performance already achieved by the top performing of similar sources. Next topic is the implementation of the standard. Actually, perhaps one of the most important pieces of the policy aspect is the successful implementation. Even it could be possible to affirm that the implementation of a policy starts during the policy design and the analysis phases, and is the most integral component to ensuring the policy achieves its intended goals. Additionally, to achieve a successful implementation, some consideration or question should be addressed to the implementation design. This question could be who, what, where, when, and how. To start with the European policies, the first important issue is to know the air quality policy and which are the main goals of this legislation. The first one, establishing minimum quality standards for ambient air. The second, tackling the problems of acid rain and ground level ozone. Three, controlling emissions from stationary and mobile sources. The fourth could be the improving fuel quality. The fifth point, the promotion and integration of environmental protection requirements into the transport and energy sectors. And finally, ensuring that the public is properly informed and can participate in the development of pollution abatement measures. Europe is acting at many levels to reduce exposure to air pollution, through legislation, through work on international level to reduce the cross-border pollution, through collaboration with sectors responsible for air pollution and with national, regional authorities and others, and through also research. On the basis of the European Union Air Quality Policy Actions, 10 directives were selected for further review. They are grouped into 5 areas represented, as can be seen in this figure. The Central Legislation on Ambient Air Quality Assessment and Management, which is the other directive, the National Emission Ceiling Directive, and the directives addressing emissions, one from stationary and other from mobile sources. The Air Quality Framework Directive and the 4 daughter directive define the legislative basis for assessment and management of air quality in the member states. The framework directives give general requirements, and the daughter directive specified the requirements for the various pollutants in more detail. An important goal of the directives is that air quality be assessed and managed in a comparable way on the basis of the same criteria in all state members. The framework directive was followed by 4 daughter directive, which set the numerical limit values, or in case of ozone, arsenic, cadmium, nickel, and benzopyrene, target values for each of the identified pollutants. The first daughter directive is related to limit values for sulfur dioxide, nitrogen dioxide, oxide of nitrogen, particulate matter, and lead. The second, that our directive is related to limit value for benzene and carbon monoxide. The third, that our directive include the ozone into the ambient air. And finally, the fourth daughter directive is related to arsenic, cadmium, mercury, nickel, and polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons in the air. The implementation by the states of the daughter directive should be coordinated with the implementation of the framework directive. The directives set the standards to be achieved, but leave to the national authorities of the different member states the choice of form and methods. The National Emission Ceilings Directive aims to limit emissions of acidifying and eutrophying pollutants and ozone precursors in order to improve the protection of human health and the environment, and to achieve the prescribed ambient air quality standards. To achieve its aim and objective, it sets upper limit to be achieved by each member state for the total emissions, for instance, national emission ceiling, of the four pollutants responsible for acidification, soil eutrophization, and ground level ozone pollution. That means sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxide, volatile carbons, organic carbons, and ammonia. Member states have to implement appropriate measures to comply with the national emission ceiling. The emission standards for stationary sources include the Large Combustion Plant Directive, which aims to gradually reduce the annual emissions of sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxides from existing plants and set emission limit values for sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxide, and thus for both existing and new plants. Control of sulfur dioxide, thus, and nitrogen oxide emission from large combustion plants plays an important role in the community effort to combat acidification, eutrophication, and ground level ozone as part of the overall strategy to reduce air pollution and to achieve the ambient air quality standard set by the Air Quality Framework Directive and its daughter directives. But what a large combustion plant is? The standard defines it as the combustion plant with a thermal input of 50 megawatts or more, not dependent to the type of fuel that is used. Additionally, the directive declares three types of large combustion plants, depending on when they were first licensed. Existing plants, licensed before July 1987. New plants, licensed between 1987 and 2002. And new plants, licensed after that date. Recently, a new directive was enacted. This is a directive on industrial emission, which is an integrated pollution prevention and control directive. Industrial production processes account for a considerable share of the overall pollution in Europe. For emission of greenhouse gases and acidifying substances, wastewater emission, and waste. In this sense, the European Union defines the obligation to be met by industrial activities with a major pollution potential. It establishes a permit procedure and lays down requirements, in particular with regards to discharges. The objective is to avoid or minimize polluting emissions in the atmosphere, water and soil, as well as waste from industrial and agricultural installations, with the aim of achieving a high level of environmental and health protection. As an integrated directive, this directive brings together in a single one on industrial emissions, the directive 2008 and six other directives. Additionally, it is important to remark that this directive contains special provisions for some installation. For example, combustion plants about 50 megawatts, waste incineration or co-incineration plants, certain installation and activities using organic solvents, and installation producing titanium dioxide. Therefore, the main objective is to achieve significant benefits to the environment and human health by reducing harmful industrial emissions across the European Union, in particular through better application of best available techniques. To do that, the integrated emission directive is based on several principles, namely an integrated approach, the best available techniques, flexibility, inspections, and of course, the public participation. The air quality standards set the parameters to different pollutants such as particles, sulfur, oxide, nitrogen, oxide, lead, carbon monoxide, benzene, ozone, arsenic, cadmium, nickel, all polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. These standards include values for different variables, for example, the maximum concentration, averaging period, legal nature, or permitted exceedances per year in most of them. Specifically, from the combustion plants, there are also some emission standards considering the size of the plant or the type of the engine or gas turbine. As can be seen in the tables, different pollutants are considered in these cases: sulfur oxide, nitrogen oxides, and particles. The values vary depending on the type of fossil fuel. In this case, the values refer to new combustion plants. As can be seen in the tables comparing these and the previous ones, these new plants have more restricted emission standards than existing plants, especially in nitrogen oxide and particle parameters. To accomplish with the standards, the emission monitoring is basic. The main aspects to be addressed in the emission monitoring are the following. The first one, periodic measurements of pollutants, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxide, and particles shall be required at least every 3 years for medium combustion plants and at least annually for medium combustion plant with a rate thermal input of which is equal or greater than 20 megawatts but less 50 megawatts. The second point is that measurements are only required for pollutants for which an emission limit value is laid down in the annex of the standard policy. The first measurements should be carried out within the 3 months following the registration of the plant. Additionally, as an alternative to the measurement of sulfur dioxide referred to in point one, other procedures verified and approved by the competent authority may be used to determine the sulfur dioxide emission. And finally, Sampling and analysis of polluting substances and measurements of processes parameters, as well as any alternative used as referred to under point 4, shall be carried out in accordance with other standards. Finally, just some main ideas about the European future trends. Europe will change its generation scheme in the next decade toward at minimum 40% of renewable in energy end use. Wind energy and photovoltaics will form the sources with the highest growing rates, while the classical fossil and nuclear power station will keep the absolute value in installed power capacity. Related to the greenhouse gas reduction goals, it has been said that by 2040, emissions are to be reduced by 60%, and even with the use of appropriate technology, no CO2 emissions should be emitted anymore by the power generation industry by 2050. Other target is the dependency reduction from suppliers of primary energy from outside of the European countries. And finally, Europe aims the efficiency improvement to reduce the cost and to protect resources.